That was great.
Well, my name is Alex, and I want to present our approach for do-it-yourself meta-languages with Canvas. So, in the next 20 to 30 minutes, I will show you the following points. Essentially, it's about our experience that we made building Cimera. It's our code generator that generates C-style languages and reads our Lisp notation for C-style languages. And while doing so, there are a couple of problems emerged, and we solved them very pragmatically. So don't be surprised that we have really pragmatic approaches for that. To illustrate that, I will show you a little bit of code. And essentially, the whole paper and the presentation is meant to be a collection of hints and clues how one can solve such problems when one wants to build a programming language. One wants to build a do-it-yourself programming language. So, where did we start? Well, our field of research is computer graphics. And in computer graphics, we mainly use C-style languages, C++, or CUDA, or shader languages like GeoRest. So designing a new language that is capable of meta-programming was not the optimal solution since time constraints. We simply wanted to use such a language. Don't design a complete language. Alternatively, we could simply extend such a language, but it's also very time-consuming and a complex task. So, alternatives would be, for example, use already existing abstraction methods inside these languages. Templates in C++. We use template metaprogramming, but template metaprogramming is only available in C++. Therefore, for example, in GeoSL or compiler code and shader code, it's not available. And it's not very nice to write, in fact. So our main idea was how can we use this style macros in our C style environment. And therefore, the easiest solution is simply use Lisp. And that's what we did. We simply embedded our target language in the Lisp notation inside Lisp. Therefore, we can easily harness Lisp power by easily using everything that Lisp offers. And the best part is we can exploit the easy notation as expressions. And absolutely the best part is we get a mighty microsystem for free. So we don't have to implement it on our own. So as I said, our target language was a C-style language, but it's not limited to C-style languages at all. So the next examples will be always cover C-style languages, but in fact, it should be not limited to that. So that's our generator. So when you are interested, take a look. There's our GitHub link. So just give it a shot. Let's have a look at the first example. Well, that's a very simple C++ program that simply prints out the ASCII arguments. That's the C-style notation, and that's our notation for the same program. So as you can see, I will highlight the mapping, and here we see where we define our main function. The parameters here are straightforward. The return type is in get. Then we have here the for loop. More or less the same. And here we have our print order. And in fact, in that case, we use a macro to simply get rid of the stdcr. In fact, this def macro is the basic usual implementation of Lisp. We didn't read our own system, our own macro. So in that case, we can simply use Lisp's already built-in function for that. So, let's focus on our Lisp input. As you can see here, we have added some new forms, for example, the include form, or the for form, or that operator. And in case we have to process these specific forms to generate our target language. And in that case, we simply want a mapping from that input to that output. And as an intermediate representation, we use an abstract syntax tree. And therefore, when we want to build an abstract syntax tree, we need at first a type of node to build it. And that's an example for our infix node, just a reduced example of that. So now is the task to build the abstract syntax tree from these nodes. And the most easy way to do so is simply wrap a macro around it. In that case, we introduce a new function, or a macro in that case, which is plus, that returns us a node type, or a node for our abstract C2 string. In that case, we can simply use it. And after macro expansion, we get our tree. For free, no extra overhead. And that's the trick. So we now have an input language, then we can simply build an abstract syntax tree, and now the next part is to process the tree. And that's the essential idea behind our processing. We have one general node type, that's the node type, and every node type is derived from that node. And we only implement one single traversal. And that's our traversal. So in that case, the traversal only looks inside our subnode's slot and recalls calls itself recursively for every node listed in that slot. So we simply traverse the slot, simply traverse the abstract syntax tree without processing in that case. So the next step is when we want to extend the functionality for our traversal, we simply define a more special method for it. In that case, we define in here our debug index version. It simply uses a more specified method and gets only called when we find an infix node. And with call next method, we simply return to the general traversal. So that's nothing special, but it's the basic idea behind the core language. So let's move on to the Lisp syntax we use here. As I already said, the dev macro is the default implementation of macro. The function and return, I used like we want them to work. So we have to redefine functions from this. In that case, when we try to do it briefly, we stumble upon the package lock. Therefore, easy solution for a very easy problem, it's use simply shadow. In that case, when you build a new language, or in that case, our new package, we want to use the plus sign. We simply import the command list, or use the command list package, and then shadow every single event of request for our own implementation. In that case, then we can use the whole macro for the plus, and use both versions. Now, when we do our major programming, we might want to switch the context to a complete scope, or in the scope. And in that case, we could introduce a Lisp macro, and then introduce a macro lib and redefine a plus to point back to the CL plus implementation. In that case, we have a normal Lisp implementation inside our language again, so we can switch back for a bigger part of our code. Well, that works quite well, since in a normal scope we have here our infix nodes, and in the Lisp block we then return to our to the normal Lisp implementation. But as you can see, the mapping is done straightforward to the CL plus after the macro expansion. But now we have one problem. We want to, when we are inside the scope, we want to escape the scope again. For example, to write our own target language expression. And to do so, we introduce an additional package where we store a third version of our implementation, just to temporarily store it and recall it later. So we can define a new macro in the swap package, but sadly, this approach doesn't work, since when we do it in that way, we simply end up again with the three. Since the swap package maps back to CMC+, again, we end up in our macro lib and then end up in the CMC+. But luckily, there's also a very simple solution, simply use the macro expand version, since macro expand called without an environment always gives back the totally defined macro. So in that case, we have a swap package plus that always gives us our implementation of the plus. So we can switch from the normal Lisp implementation to our implementation back and forth. So the next problem we stumbled upon was the case, since Lisp seems to be not case sensitive, but our target languages are. In that case, when we write our code and then general code, and we end up with an upcased version, normally that's not that what we want. So again, the first try was to use the preserve keyword for the read table case. But if we do so, we end up with a very strange syntax, since now we have to write all this code in uppercase to meet the implementation. But we can use our, when we define a new function, we can use them in our lowercase version afterwards. But this doesn't seem to work right or look right. So we use the invert version. Well, normally when we use the without changing the read table case, we end up in an upcase version. But when we use the invert version, we end up with a preserved version. Well, in that case, the invert happens while reading and again when writing. So we end up in the end with a preserved case. And the best part is, in the intermediate representation, we end up with the inverted version. So we use a lowercase input. For example, we want to call a list function. We use the lowercase version, then we get an invert, and then it maps perfectly for the already present list upcase version. So, no problem, we have a mixed intermediate representation and end up with a preserved version. Perfect. But there's some exception, since when we use inter, we miss the first initial inversion. So we have to implement our own internal version that does the additional invert in the first step. But we have to take account and we got a mixed case that doesn't change. So that was the case problem. And then we came up with an additional idea. So we can use, for example, such syntax known from C and C++. We can use, for example, the prefix increment or pointer arrays or arrays of pointer, and then your array access. Well, in that case of the asterisk, that's quite simple to process that. Since we can simply add a macro character, define our function that simply consumes our symbol and then emits a valid form in that case, DRAM. But that doesn't work in that case, since in that case we have two macro characters, we want to use the plus, or here in that case we have the macro characters in the end of the symbol, and in that case we have sort of a complex symbol. But luckily all three versions, all three symbols have one character in common, and that's the white space. Therefore we can simply implement one general reader function that simply captures every symbol and process every possible short writing syntax. So in that case we can process almost anything. For example, such an expression simply emit the equivalent form syntax. For example, nested array accesses for concatenated pointer references. It doesn't work in every place, since list pads normally don't have a leading white space. They have an opening parent, and therefore we have an additional function that simply reads a list, modifies the first element, and returns the list with a modified first element. And then we can, for example, use it to identify function calls, which are, for example, here we have a function call, remember function from an array. But we don't want to access it in every. We don't want to modify every symbol. Since, for example, that one, the postfix plus plus, seems also like a postfix increment. So we end up in an infinite loop when we want to process that one. So we have to check if a if a symbol is found or a function is found, and then process it or simply use it like it's already there. So, but I will come back to that later. First, we have an additional exception, and that are namespaces. Since namespaces in C++ have the double colon notation and double colon notation in Lisp package. So we end up with that notation, which is simply a dispatch macro character, and the function is equally true. That we simply use a colon reader that emits us here from namespace. And we generate them afterwards appropriate recording of the namespace. So let's go to the next example, a more interesting one. This program reads an image RGB image and write some grayscale image. So we mix them. Here we see that we mix colors and then we write pixel and we write the image. And in the beginning we set up the in image, the out image, and we loop here over every pixel from the input image. So I want to highlight some points here. That was fun. As you can see here, we want to show that we have here a constructor call with an identifier. So that function is not known at that point. The same goes here for that one in image, where we want to get type. That's a member function call, or here the out image of a member function call. Then we have condition to testing point, that's here. The decal is something like a Latin list. So we declare new variables. And in that case, it's quite similar to a special form, but it's not really a special form. In that case, we have a semi-special form. In that case, we have here, for example, the qualifier and specifier, the type and identifier. But we also can use forms in that case, as you can see here. That instantiate is a template instantiation for C++. And then we can mix them again with from namespaces or elements from other namespaces. Again, we can mix them again in here. For example, use the const and then type from other namespaces. So, next part is then that's essentially the concept of the name, dot list. And then we can generate here our main CPP. And that's the result. Essentially the same, but as you can see, I highlight the same points. We have here our constructor call, we have our here member function call, and here member function call, and here are our new variables and types. That one, and here, instantiation for the tables. Here the next part. So, one might ask, what's the point behind it? Well, we want this one to use for, as I said, for meta programming. And that's the point. That's the next step. Then we can simply modify code fragments. In that case, we use simply macro label. And then replace our template instantiation with a macro. Returns us a from namespace. In that case, it's an explicit form where you can pass in arguments. That's not all. That's not the end. We can also modify specific symbols, like in that case. We use a simple macro name, and in that case it would, that would also suffice. And we can modify, for example, here, that part. In that case, we simply switch the colors. So we simply switch or change the simple values. And that works, since the reader reads that point, that symbol, and emits us an ORF for. And that ORF form, almost all forms in our case are quasi special forms, so we can edit the symbols, but don't have to. So, and how do we do this? How do we find bound functions or symbols? Well, normally that's quite easy. We simply use bound P, but it doesn't work for that. And fbound P works for functions, but fbound P doesn't work for labels, flat macro, or symbol macro. So we don't know if a function is a function or symbol bound or not. But we can write it out. Since we have one very interesting function for SPCR enclosure, and that's the variable information. So we can simply query the environment and show, well, is there somewhere information for that symbol? And when we find something, well, it's bound. And when we don't have such implementation, we simply search inside the environment and find information for it. So, and when we don't find them, they're unbound, and then we know an unbound function or unbound symbol, well, they don't make sense in this environment. So they're possibly meant for the target language. The same works for fbound p in that case, where we simply use function information. The same effect. And since we have or need access to the environment variable, we have to put them inside a macro. So nothing special. In that case, we can simply check if a symbol is found or not. Well, and how do we process symbols? The idea behind this, when we have a function, for example, the defun var, we know it's there, and we find it in our code, then we use the function that is, that is present. So we have to tweak. If we don't have a function implementation, for example, the bus, since it's commented out, then we use it as a function call. The same goes for the Reddit one wants to have explicitly call such a function that is present, then you simply call it that you want to have a function call and then call it. Since function call in that case is a semi special form too, so we can replace such calls too. But that's essentially my talk. So I must admit our approach is very pragmatic, but it's to our taste. It works, it's simple, it's easy to hack, and we can simply use it without much overhead. We don't claim that it's the perfect idea, the perfect solution for that, but we hope that some of you might get a hint or clue how perhaps some specific problems might be solved. So in general, our paper was the idea that it's a collection of hints and clues, so one can find inspiration there. And if we had that paper in the beginning, it would have helped us a lot. So thank you very much.
Yes, there are questions I would like to ask Ara, but I'm also. You first.
Okay, could you go back to slide 32?
32.
Sorry, this one. Yes, this one.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I see now. This is a macro because it needs the environment.
Exactly.
Okay.
So I don't exactly understand the motivation because for most of the time it looks kind of like you wanted to write a C++ but with S expressions. What's the point? Because when I look at the code, it looked like you didn't gain much anything.
Macros. You want to use macros.
Yeah, because you use the approach of using reader macros a lot, but it kind of looks like within the approach of defining the C stuff, like the function include as macros be better. Because right now, for example, when you had the STD namespace, you had to use your own reader notation, which also looks like something we already have in common list to not intern the symbols. And at first I thought it was just not interning the symbol STD for some reason, but turned out you just implemented a reader macro for that. When you had a plus sign, you had to throw a few things here and there in the code to make these things work, and it looked like a lot of hassle to just achieve something simple.
Well, yes, it is essentially simple, but our goal was macros. And the idea behind this is we can, as I showed, we have a specific part of code and we can modify it afterwards. And that's the motivation. I hope I can show you my background slides. So, for example, this is code from our last year's paper. It's not actual.
Yeah.
So that's where we use our meta programming style, where we can build our macros, our macros for macros. And then this one was a code snippet used as an input for specific macro. And the idea behind this was to generate different output code fragments useful for different architectures. For example, the basic implementation was to simply map this one as an input to a Scala output. So we have here the Scala processing of the same of this part. But the idea now, afterwards, we can simply use this one as an input, wrap it around with macros, and modify the content to generate vectorized code.
Okay.
Completely with macros, without even touching the code itself.
Sure. Last question. Do you know C macro? Library. It's list macros but for C. So you can write in C macros that are common list style. Like you could also do something like that, but instead of writing common list macros and then evaluating common list macros to C++ code, you could write in C++ with list macros with C syntax, and then use this C macro compiler to change the macros into the code and then run.
Mm-hmm.
So it's also already there, I can show you later.
Maybe you can talk later
yes.
about this short topic. Are there any more questions? Yes.
Yeah, I find great that you'd be using space as a macro character. I thought it would not be possible. And so I wonder how difficult it was to make this work in different compilers. Like it seems like you've been using SDCL and others. So I will have a look at your code, but just to give me some insight.
What's the white space reader explicitly? The white space reader is very simple. Simply
this is, yeah?
Yes. Say your micro character and then white space. And then
right. Thank you. Have you heard about reasoning?
Not yet, but I heard it yesterday from you.
Okay.
I'll so, talk later. I'm very interested in that topic.
So, from your main memory, you can tell them from this. And then you can write grammars, and you have parsing of the grammar, and you can start a generator. So, for your parsing of symbols to get variables and array references, you could have a grammar generator, which would reversely generate
Sure, we'll have a look at that.
Yes,
so have you seen your presentation about the vertices reached by Major Emerson a few years ago with CCLM? So in CCL they have similar things for the vertices, they have similar individual markers to reference particular Cocoa style of things, so you can see it. Yeah. So they should play and, also, I had similar experience designing such languages and even in English itself. And this way, so the question is can you consider just using a particular macro character, for instance, add or something else, to prefix all the C extensions you like,
and
then expand it inside?
That's essentially a design decision. So we want it that way. So of course you can always write C, then the imperative and the iPhone and then your function not wanted it that way. So that's essentially why it's so.
Yes. Can you test this library?
Well, yes, we can test the resulting code, so not the library itself.
Other questions? Really not. Why not just come on this with the basic libraries you use?
Well, it's essentially we want to use, for example, CUDA code. We want to generate CUDA code. And the initial idea was also to have shader code. Shader code doesn't support this in that case. So we have OpenGL, GL SL code, and it's essentially C code. In that case, we wanted to cover the use C code and see what we can actually make. That's essentially the idea.
Yeah. Last one. How do you handle errors? So when you generate C code and compile that C code and it drops an error off you, how do you make the connection about the generated code and the missing one?
I'm looking at the result.
Okay.
But we also we had a version where we print out initial line partners.
Mm-hmm.
Then we can point back to the original list file. So even the debugger could handle the list file action. But it's not active.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.